tonight's meeting of the pension fund, the pensions committee, and thank you for a good attendance this evening on a warm September evening, and particular welcome actually to Tammy Byron, who's our councillor from Knowsley, who's made a long journey to be with us tonight. So thank you for your efforts. We do have some apologies. First of all, from Councillor Nick Croft from Liverpool, John Fulham from St Helens, who's unable to attend, and Pat Cleary, the trade union representative, who's also not able to be with us this evening. So other than that, thank you for your attendance. And first of all, can we just check if there's any declarations of interest?
Page 18 of the report summarises findings against the one significant risk that we identified in the audit plan that was specific to the pension fund account, and that was in respect of the valuation of the level 3 investments. We identified that as a significant risk because level 3 investments by their nature involve a significant degree of judgment to reach a valuation at the year end. The table there on that page just summarises the work that we've completed and our conclusions. Again, no material issues, no significant issues to report in respect of the level 3 investments. We did identify one investment where the audit opinion on the financial statements relating to that investment had been qualified. There were two matters in that qualification. There was an emphasis of matter in the audit opinion. Management had considered the nature of those matters and are satisfied that there are no impacts, significant impacts on your investment. But we've raised a recommendation which is set out in Appendix A to ensure that there are comprehensive procedures in place to review all audit opinions on such investments and ensure that the fund is satisfied that there is no implications for any of the investments that you hold. Pages 19 to 21 then go on to summarise our findings in the other areas where we focused our audit work. Again, no significant matters arising here. There was one small issue set out on page 19 where we identified one new investment that hadn't been recorded on the investment ledger. We were happy that was an isolated instance, and management have now corrected that. Page 22 of your papers summarises our findings in respect of accounting policies, estimates and judgments. And again, green ratings there across each of those areas. We're happy that the fund's approach is appropriate and there are no significant matters to report there. Page 23 summarises various communication requirements that were required to either communicate to you or to seek from those general governance or from management. The only thing I'd highlight there is just against item 4. We've requested a letter of representation from the fund, which will go to the Audit and Risk Management Committee next week. Within that, we've just asked for a very specific representation regarding ownership of one of the assets. And that's just because you're only sharing that asset, so it's difficult for us to evidence ownership in the same way that we would for assets, property assets that are wholly owned by the fund. I guess that's nothing unusual then, it's something we would apply in the circumstances where there were similar ownership arrangements in place. Page 25, as I said at the beginning, there were no significant amendments. We agreed a small number of minor amendments with management just to improve overall disclosure and presentation. And there was one reclassification and one item of the accounts just to reclassify the description of that item to make sure it was appropriately described. Page 27 summarises fees, no changes to fees as set out in the audit plan. And then finally, I've mentioned already the recommendation, which is in Appendix A on page 31. And Appendix B and C set out the proposed audit opinion and the opinion on the pension fund annual report. It's one thing just to mention whilst I'm referencing the opinions in Appendix B and C. This audit findings report and the draft opinions were prepared with Fiona named as the engagement leader who signed the opinion. Unfortunately, Fiona, she was involved in a car accident at the end of the month. She's recovering and recovering well, but she was due to take early retirement at the end of this month and would have come to this committee to tell you it was going to be her last audit opinion. She's not now going to sign the opinion, but we've got arrangements in place for another engagement lead with extensive local government pension fund experience who will sign the opinion for you on the 2015-16 financial statements. That's a lady called Jackie Bellard, and she will attend the Audit and Risk Management Committee next week. They were the highlights, key messages. I'm happy to take any questions or comments from anybody on the committee.
Yeah, that's it. On page 23, item 4, you said you requested a letter of representation from the fund. Did you say you actually had the letter now? I think you said it's going. I'm not sure where it's going exactly next.
Sorry, the letter of representation will come from the chair of the Audit and Risk Management Committee as it relates to the accounts as they are included within Wirral's accounts. And that's signed by the chair of the Audit and Risk Management Committee on the section 1 of the Civil Wirral.
Okay, thanks.
item 4, statements of accounts, which Donna, you're going to talk through with us.
Thank you, Chair. The purpose of this report is to present members with the auditor of the statements of accounts of Merseyside Pension Fund for 2015-16 and to respond to the previous item on this agenda, the audit findings report from the Bank Accountant. The statements of accounts are included within MPF's draft annual report, which is item 5 on this agenda, which is page 66 to 86 of the pack. The value of the fund as at 31st of March 2016 was £6.8 million. I do not propose to go through the accounts at this meeting, but I'm happy to take any questions. As previously discussed on the previous item, the accounts have been subject to external audit over the summer, and the previous item includes the findings of that external review. In response to the Grant Thornton report, officers have agreed to the suggested adjustments to the accounts and the disclosures. Within the audit findings against the significant risks of the Grant Thornton report, all issues arising have been resolved. The recommendation contained within the Grant Thornton report has been agreed by fund officers, and MPF continues to work with our pooling partners and is agreeing enhanced monitoring procedures, which will include that being recommended by Grant Thornton. Overall, the Grant Thornton report is a positive report and reflects the hard work undertaken by fund officers. 2.8 of this report informs members that a letter of representation has been prepared on behalf of this committee and gives assurances to the auditor on various aspects relating to the pension fund. As previously discussed, the letter will be signed by the Section 151 officer and the Chair of Audit and Risk Management Committee following that committee meeting. Section 13 asks members of Pensions Committee to approve the auditor's statements of accounts for 15-16, consider the amendments to the draft accounts and the audit findings report and the letter of representation. Section 13 also asks members of Pensions Committee on approval and consideration of the previous point to refer the recommendation to Audit and Risk Management Committee. There is a statutory requirement to bring this item to committee as stated detailed in Section 14. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, thank you, Donna, for explaining that process to us. Are there any questions? If not, are we happy to agree the recommendations as contained in items 4 and 5, really? We can take them jointly, can't we? Be happy to agree those recommendations. Thank you. I just wish that we'd photoshopped my picture a little bit more. Still look as fast as I did 2 years ago. Right. I'm really pleased that we have with us John Mason, who's Chair of our board, and agenda item 6 is going to give us a report on the work and the review of the board to date. Thank you, John.
The report on page 103 to 111 of your agenda pack. As independent chair, I am required to prepare the report for the board and to present it to you annually. This report was prepared by myself and then approved by the board in this meeting in June 2016. The report covers the board's first year, which was from the 15th of May 2015 when the members were appointed to the 30th of April 2016. That certainly covered first three meetings of the board. The review starts by considering the establishment of the board, as the actual effectiveness of the board really was very much dependent at the beginning, not only on the membership, but also the approach the administrative authority, I will, took to the establishment of the board. And the review is very clear that Will, as the administrative authority, took a clearly proactive and positive approach to the creation and nature of the board. The statutory requirement is that you have two employer and two employee representatives. In fact, you established a board with four employer and four employee representatives and independent chair. In establishing that board, you've enabled proper representation across the employer groups. That's one for admitted bodies, one for education bodies, and two for what I call authorities, that's councils, police, fire and transport. Diversity amongst employees was guaranteed as two representatives were to be actives and the other two were to be pensioners or deferred members. An independent chair was to have experience either as a trustee or as an officer, preferably within the LGPS, a former LGPS officer like that, North Hampshire Fund and Arts Director, Chief Finance Officer, North Hampshire County Council later, under Wall and Forest. The Mifflin Society undertook a big pensions avenue for the three bonds team out of court by employers, which we should do. And probably also the pensions employees, and the employees' concerns, their services recorded, and they get payments paid out properly. So pensions avenue is a big issue, I think, for the board, and fund officers have worked to develop reports for the board to show standards and performance levels against which they're working. During the first year, we didn't make any formal recommendations to the scheme manager or pension board. We now turned it over to make formal recommendations to. We didn't feel the need to do that, but we did pass one resolution unanimously, and I support it as a member of the chair as well, which was to support your approach to Doughty, because the approach that Northern Powerhouse is taking is somewhat different to that of some of the other boards, and the employers and the employees and myself felt that was particularly appropriate. Seeks to involve as much as possible the administrators are to be elected members, you know, in the future delivery of investment management. The final thing I just really want to say is that I'd like to thank the officers, Peter, Yvonne, Guy, Donna, and Joe Gloss, because throughout the year, all of them, I have to say, have given a lot of support to the board as a whole, also to myself, because there's been quite a lot of correspondence and conversations outside of board meetings, and it's been extremely positive support this week. So really, Chair, I'd just like to thank the officers in particular.
Thank you, John, for that presentation. If I could just comment on this, when we first spoke about boards, it's a long while ago now, 2 years ago, whenever it was, it seemed to me that our officers were well in advance of the preparation that was required, and I think that preparation and effort and work has really paid off. I know I've been to pensions conferences, talking to chairs and members from other authorities, and I think that our officers and John and our board have performed particularly well, and really, really grateful for the work that they've done and how supportive they've been to this committee. So I'd like to extend my thanks publicly to our officers for the work that they've put in advance, and to John for cheering us so well for us. So thank you for that. Is there any questions of John? Okay, thank you. So we'll move on to Yvonne, who's going to give us an update on the local government pension scheme.
Amen. 10% of the amber raising for asset drop. This measures the change in employer contributions as a percentage of payroll after a 15% fall in return seeking assets. The fund factory is fed back to GAD by using payroll as a measure as flawed, as it's not a true reflection of an employer's affordability to meet increased contributions, and GAD are reviewing the metric. 2.14 notes that long-term cost efficiency means that employer contribution rates must not be set at a level which will lead to additional costs in the future. Again, there are 10 measures to assess long-term cost efficiency, and the fund rated green against all measures as proof of the fund's sensible funding and deficit repair plan. Paragraph 3.1 highlights the risk that Section 13 measures could influence decision making as opposed to the fund's own local circumstances. Paragraph 8 confirms that officers will consider the Section 13 reporting requirements as part of the 2016 evaluation process, but do not believe this will influence the results due to the robust assumptions within our funding plan. The recommendation is that members should consider the Section 13 measures as part of the evaluation, but any decision on funding should be based on one's own circumstances, risk profile and long-term objectives. And I'm happy to take any questions on Section 13.
So we have a solvent, secure and efficient fund, it would seem. And certainly like to thank Yvonne for putting that together for us. But do we have any questions? Can I ask Yvonne then how we measured in relation to other funds? I know it's early days, but if we can give us some sort of indication how we fare so far.
The report does mention a couple of outliers within the report, which obviously the society judgment doesn't fall within because we've hit all green measures. There is an alternative measure to measure funding and valuations. Our funding level based on our own funding obviously prudence and assumptions we use. We were at 76% at last valuation 2013. Using GAD's discount rate to measure solvency, our funding level went up to 93%, which shows that we are retaining prudence within our contribution, within our assumptions, so that if there is any adverse impacts on market conditions, that we can shoulder any increase in contribution rates. But a lot of other funds we're using, I would say half the funds we're using prudent assumption, whereas depending on what actuarial firm we use, that their assumptions were not that prudent and they didn't see the increase in the funding level as we did under GAD's scale growth.
Well, all sounds good to me. We're happy with the recommendations and thank you all for the production of that report. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, agenda item 10 is an update on the cooling consultation, which Peter will talk through. There is an exempt part to this this item. So over to Peter.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I did bring an interim report to the July committee, but we needed to finalise the submission, which we did in consultation with the Chair, and it was made on the 15th of July. The appendices to the report provide full details.
conference. Seemed to me to be some basket cases amongst some of the pools, and I think we're very fortunate indeed to have three like-minded funds, well organised, all committed to the same purpose, and I think a lot of people would like to be in the north from some of the pools that have already been sort of created to date. So thanks again to all officers, and you know, I would recommend this to you, and look forward to government's response to allow us to proceed as we've started. So thank you, Peter, for that. I'm happy to go along with the recommendations of this report. Over to Peter again with reference to fundamentals training in defence.
Yes, thank you. Bring a number of training opportunities to committee, but I would, as the report explains, recommend this as a foundation training opportunity for the new members of committee and a refresher for longer serving members. It is over 3 days in three different venues, so hopefully it's sufficiently flexible to accommodate the diary requirements. As I say, it's useful because it's bespoke in terms of focusing on the LGPS, and it will give new members of committee an insight to their responsibilities and to the various aspects of the LGPS. Thank you, Chair.
This particular training has really come home to me when I've reflected upon the commitments of the board members and considered my own training needs and what I've achieved so far and my knowledge. So I've committed to this particular 3 days of training, the first one being on the 6th of October, and then two follow-on dates in Leeds. I'd really like to encourage those who've not been able to participate in this training event to if they can. I know it's 3 days out of your diary, and sometimes, you know, it's not always convenient, but there are different dates and different locations, so if I could just encourage you as members to make yourselves available if you've not had the opportunity to attend these events, or to in fact refresh yourselves of some of the essential knowledge that we need to have as members of this committee. And if you can make it, please let Emma know, and she'll book you into the events and make arrangements for you. So thank you for that report, Peter.
Likewise, the following item is our annual advice conference, which the Chair of the Pension Board alluded to. It's a morning of entry race course. It's accessible. I would suggest this time not spent. We have a presentation from the fund actuary, which is particularly relevant as it's our final evaluation this year. There'll be a review of the Pension Board activities, and fund officers will also be updating on the activities of the fund over the year. Past 12 months. So again, it's a concise way of us covering quite a wide range of the fund activities. Thank you, Chair.
Again, if I can recommend this event to you, it's really a well put together morning, and I for one have learned and gained a lot from it on the 2 years that I've attended. And also, when I read this report, I thought it can't be right, actually, because Guy puts this event together for £7,500, and when you see what goes into it, I'm actually astonished that he achieves that that level of budgetary. You know, it does really well, and it's an excellent event. So again, I know it's half a day as well, diaries, but I could really recommend it to all members if you can make it. And there's always an excellent lunch provided. And if you've not been to Adrian race course before, it's a nice morning. So I can just commend that to all members of this committee. Okay, we have agenda item 12, which is pension board minutes, which are really for noting. And then agenda item 13 is an infrastructure report. There is an exempt item to that as well. That's in the, if all members have got this supplementary. Yeah, okay. So Peter's going to present that to us. As I say, there is an exempt item as part of this agenda.
Thank you,
make comments. Did we see any restrictions to infrastructure investment? I said as long as it was nothing south of Stoke, but not quite sure how well that was received. But you know, I think it's really good that we have like-minded partners here that we can work towards benefiting from their expertise, their experience with Manchester, West Yorkshire, and Lancashire, and the London Pension Fund Authority as well, and learning from them, working with them, and looking for a suitable investment opportunities. So I think we're doing quite well, and I look forward to ongoing reports dealing with this. So thank you, Peter. We're happy to note the report. Okay. I'm going to ask Peter to guide me a little bit here. I think that agenda item 14 is an exempt item. Yeah. And following on from that, I think the other items are exempt items also. I'm happy to be corrected and guided, but on that basis, under section 100A4 of the Local Government Act 1972, that the public be excluded from the meeting during consideration of the following items of business on the grounds that they involve the likely disclosure of exempt information as defined by the relevant paragraphs of Part 1, Schedule 12A, as amended to that Act. The public interest test has been applied and favours exclusion. So, if I can ask someone to move that, happy to move that, Geoff? Seconded? So, okay. So can I thank members of the public for your attendance, as always?
Sorry, included in the resolution, because you've added two new items, I think it's 14 and 15, you've got to give a reason as to why you're excluding us for those now.
Absolutely. Yeah, both 14 and 15, there are exempt items in both of those agenda items.
So you have to give a reason why you're excluding us for those as well?
Yeah, there are personal information and details that members of the public contain therein. Thank you for that comment.
It's just a legal requirement to be in the resolution.
Absolutely, okay. Thank you.